Homosexuality is a sin.
Well, hello to you too.
As a matter of fact, it's mentioned as a sin in the Bible multiple times, so there's no argument there.
Yes, I have read through the passages that you're sure to point to several times. However, I feel that I must inquire further about what constitutes a sin, and not just where you get the idea that certain things are considered to be sinful, as most Christians clearly cherry-pick those straight from their Bible, being careful, of course, to exclude any that are overly inconvenient, such as the passages that forbid you from wearing garments of mixed fabrics, or those which forbid the consumption of shellfish. Rather, what I'm curious to find out is what it is that all of those things which you hold to be sinful have in common, that even apart from the Bible, could be an understandable through-line through which one could be justified in determining which actions are morally acceptable and which are not.
However, just because you are gay does not mean that you're going to hell, and it doesn't mean that you can't be a Christian.
Well, I suppose that is a less reprehensible starting position to hold than many other people that I've heard speak on this issue over the years, but I will admit that personally it's always bothered me watching the same members of the LGBTQ+ community who were rejected and cut off from a particular sect of Christianity merely running to another sect rather than using the disillusionment from the initial distancing as a catalyst to finally see Christianity for what it is from the outside. Especially due to the fact that most of the more liberal churches that they run to likely used to discriminate against people like them just as harshly, but lightened up in recent years to fit the general social norm of the present political climate, as religion is always forced to do in order to survive. While I do recognize what a comfort religion can be for some people, part of me sometimes wonders whether it would be better for estranged religious members of the LGBTQ+ community if there were no Christian denominations that accepted them at all, so long as that lack of acceptance never escalated to anything that would actively seek to cause them harm. Would having less access to more liberal Christian sects help people to eventually recognize the falsity within the religion as a whole, or would the net result be something less desirable if that were the case? I'm curious as to everyone's thoughts on this. If you have a strong opinion one way or another, I would love to hear your reasoning for it in the comments down below.
So homosexuality is a sin. Just like stealing, lying, cheating, sex before marriage, watching pornography, it's all sin.
Stealing, lying, cheating, premarital sex, watching pornography, and being gay. How can we group these things in a way that makes sense? Well, right off the bat, what sticks out to me is the moral inequality between the first three items listed, stealing, lying, and cheating, and the second three items listed, premarital sex, watching pornography, and being gay. That discrepancy, to me, comes in the simple fact that the first three actions have clear victims in most cases, whereas the second set is made up of actions that do not create victims. If one were to apply a veil of ignorance to these things, the difference becomes even more clear. If you were to, theoretically, be entering into a world which consisted of two groups, one which was allowed to steal anything they wanted from the members of the other group, would you feel comfortable being dropped into that world with no knowledge of whether you were going to end up as a member of the group who was doing the stealing or of the group that was being stolen from? Most likely not. The same could also likely be said about the other two options from the first group. Now, what if the world you were being blindly dropped into had two groups of people, one group straight and the other group gay? Would you feel more comfortable being dropped into that world under conditions which permitted people to be gay, or under conditions which did not? As you may find yourself being dropped into this world as a gay man, one would assume that you would likely feel less comfortable being put into this world if it were hostile towards you just for being a member of that group. Likewise, if you ended up straight in a world which does not discriminate against the other group merely for being gay, you lose nothing. So in this case, the justifiably moral position and the one that you would want being dropped into this world would be the one which does not create a victim, that being the position which does not discriminate against people for being gay. And interestingly enough, when you look at the laws in most secular civilized countries, what you will find is that there are laws to varying degrees against lying, cheating, and stealing, as they inherently create victims, but not against premarital sex, watching pornography, or being gay, as they do not inherently create victims. The reason that this way of thinking is so consistent across secular societies, but not across different denominations of Christianity, is because, as logical human beings, it is beneficial to safeguard against actions which cause harm to others, but makes little sense to discriminate against people for things that are done consensually and without causing harm to either party. The Bible, despite being the conduit through which all Christians are meant to derive all of their objective morality, only serves to inhibit the natural ability of people to empathize and determine for themselves what is a moral way to treat others. All of this to reiterate, other than a book of mythology and your strong personal conviction in its authenticity, what are you actually basing your morality on that is both consistent and justifiable?
Meaning, stealing a candy bar from a candy store and being gay, one is not looked at higher or worse than the other. It's all sin. God looks at all sin the same.
And yet, there is the common claim that your God, who you surely believe is the personification of all that is morally good in the universe, looks at actions which produce a victim, such as stealing a candy bar, and actions which do not, such as having consensual sex with a member of your same sex, as being morally congruent, which makes no actual practical sense and essentially makes any discussion of morality under the presupposition of your particular choice deity completely arbitrary, as there is no rhyme or reason behind what your God considers to be a sin as opposed to what he considers to be morally acceptable.
And this is something that you've probably heard a lot from what I like to call so-called Christians.
Leaning into the no true Scotsman fallacy early on, are we?
If you're gay, you're going to hell because you're living a life that's not pleasing to God. I'm here to tell you that you can be gay and still love Jesus and have a relationship with Jesus. You can be gay and still go to heaven, and you can love God and still choose to live in sin.
Well, yes, of course you can. I mean, unless you ask the members of a different sect of Christianity which believes differently from you. Seeing as how both you and the members of Christian denominations that disagree with you are getting all of your doctrine from the exact same book, you would think that an omnipotent God could express his intent effectively enough that his true message would be properly interpreted, but that is evidently not the case, as your positions are mutually exclusive in many regards. Personally, I have a theory as to why so many Christians choose to accept members of the LGBTQ+ community despite the Bible's rather explicit condemnation of them. My theory is that many Christians, although few of them would ever admit it, know deep down that what the Bible says on this matter, no matter how explicit, is morally reprehensible. For this reason, it's not uncommon for good people to be forced into the choice of either abandoning Christianity altogether in order to live by what they know in their heart to be right, holding on to most of their beliefs, but finding an excuse to dismiss the one, very often doctrine regarding homosexuality, that causes internal conflict between what the supposedly infallible book is telling them and what they know to be morally justifiable, or to turn their back on what they know to be morally true in order to cling to the word of a book which was written centuries before they were even born. It seems to me that you likely fit into the middle category, of being a good enough person at heart that you had to find a way to justify a lighter stance on homosexuality for yourself, but being unwilling to completely abandon the rest of your faith.
If homosexuality is a sin, you can choose to live that way, and Jesus is still gonna love you. Don't get me wrong, it is a sin, but it doesn't mean that that sin sends you to hell.
Well, no, of course that sin alone won't send you to hell, but then again, not even rape or murder will send you straight to hell, because they may create victims of some of the worst things that people can possibly do to one another, but even they can be forgiven by God, especially when he personally orders those actions to be carried out, as happens so frequently in the Bible. No, there is only one sin that is truly unforgivable, and in keeping with our theme, it is, of course, a victimless sin. The victimless sin of disbelief. No matter how many atrocities you commit, if you but believe and turn from your ways, you have earned eternal bliss in heaven. But in contrast, no matter how moral a person you may be, if you do not believe in God, not only do you not deserve eternal bliss, as is rewarded to rapists and murderers, so long as they believe, you instead have earned eternal punishment, all for the victimless crime of disbelief.
In the book of Romans chapter 5 and 6, it talks about sin and the way that God views sin. And I'm going to read you a couple verses, but I would encourage you to read all of chapter 5 and all of chapter 6 to see what sin is and see how God views sin. Romans chapter 5 verses 20 all the way up to chapter 6 towards verse 3, it says this: "The law was brought in so that trespass, in other words sin, might increase. But where sin increased, all the more grace increased. So that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness to bring eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that the grace may be increased? By no means. We are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have new life."
I suppose I may have been a bit early on my last interjection, as this passage has only further reinforced it. The greater the sin, the greater the grace offered for it. If you but believe and repent, there is no sin which cannot be forgiven. apart from disbelief.
So to close this out, yes, homosexuality is a sin.
Which, I will reiterate, is a term which is so ill-defined outside of the context of your choice book of mythology that it holds no consistent or justifiable tie to morality at all.
You can give God some areas of your life and hold on to other areas. Now, is that what God wants? No. But does he still love you? Absolutely. And frankly, it's not my job or anybody else's job to tell you that you're going to hell, okay?
And while I am glad that this is a position which you hold, I feel the need to draw attention to the fact that, again, the picture which you have on screen right now is yet another Christian who derived their ideas from the exact same book that you have. A book that is supposedly infallible and is supposed to have been written by an omnipotent being. With this being the case, I will ask again, why would an omnipotent God not have the ability to have his true message be received by everybody who reads his book? If your God has the desire for everybody to understand his message properly when they read the Bible, but does not have the ability to make it happen, he is not omnipotent. If your God has the ability to make those who read the Bible understand the truth of his message, but chooses not to do so, thus letting his own people tear others and each other apart, then he is not omnibenevolent. In short, the very fact that both you and the man holding the signs in that picture hold different views but arrived at them from the same supposedly infallible source means that your God as the all-good, all-powerful being that you believe him to be not only does not exist, but necessarily cannot exist.
Our job is to love on you and show people the love that God has for them. So I hope this video clears things up. I hope it makes sense. I realize this is a touchy topic and there's going to be a lot of sensitivity on both sides, but this is truly what the Bible says about homosexuality. That's the end of this video, and I will see you in the next one. Peace.
Those of you who have been with my channel for a decent amount of time now will likely remember a smaller channel by the name of Biblical Prophecies that I made several responses to about homosexuality, marijuana, and questions about Judas Iscariot. My goal with those videos was to follow that channel along and keep it honest as it continued to update with new content. As that channel has not uploaded in over a year and only ever had 5 videos on it, I feel like it's doubtful that we will ever hear from him again. In the meantime, I feel like this channel might work as a nice replacement, as it is relatively new, with uploads starting only a month ago, and there are already 5 videos up on it, so I'm assuming that he will be continuing. I've left a comment under the original video expressing my intent to respond to it, so perhaps our new pet project may end up being more aware of us than our last one was. If that is the case, I would like to welcome you to the channel, Charles, or at least I assume that's your name, based on another channel that you have linked in the description to your first upload on this one. As I said, I'll be here to follow your journey on YouTube and to keep you from ever feeling as if you have the luxury of being able to make a claim without having somebody be ready to challenge it if the need should arise. I look forward to seeing what you create in the future. To the rest of you, I appreciate you for making it to the end of this video and would love to hear what you thought. Be sure to subscribe if you haven't already, and if you're feeling generous, check out the God Is Not Good merch shop in the description down below, as it is the best way to support my content, and 10% of your purchase will be donated to a secular charity. Thank you all very much for watching, and as always, have a blessed day, fellow heathens.